بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. So last time we finished talking about the physical layer and the main functionalities of the physical layer, which are encoding and signaling, and we talked about the different physical media and the properties of each one. Today, inshallah, we will go one floor up in the stack and start talking about the data link layer. So data link layer, of course, it lies in between what the network layer and the physical layer. Okay, so here lies the data link layer. Like all the other layers, there are two basic functionalities that every layer has to perform. These are the minimum basic functionalities that each layer has to perform. Lomay, what are the basic functionalities that every single layer has to perform? When it receives something from the lower layer, it has to do something. When it receives something from the upper layer, it has to do something. Which is what we call the encapsulation and decapsulation. Bravo. So when I receive bits from the physical layer, I have to decapsulate. By decapsulation, I mean I have to identify what is the header, what is the trailer, process the header and the trailer, and then send up some data without the header and the trailer. And when I receive something from the upper layer, I have to do a encapsulation, which means I have to add the header and the trailer to the data. I have to add the envelope. So these are two basic functionalities that have to exist in every single layer. In addition to this, data link layer has some specific functionalities which are distinct to the data link layer. One of these functions are error checking. By error checking, I mean when I receive the packet from the network layer, I have to first perform some framing. So I have to add the header and the trailer. So the first thing that happens in the network layer is that I have to add some error checking here as part of the trailer. And this error checking is very important. Why? Because there's no point for the data link layer, when it receives the frame, okay, if the data has some error, does it make any sense to send it up when I do the encapsulation? If the data has some error, even if in one bit, okay, when I send it up, I'm wasting the time of all the layers above to process something that has some error, okay? So there's no point. So this error checking field will get created during encapsulation, and then at the receiver side, when the data link layer tries to decapsulate, it will have to check this error checking field. The error checking field is nothing but some combination of the data, so that if the data has any bit changes, then the error checking field will not be valid anymore. Okay? Like, for example, the simplest, I can count the number of ones in the data, okay? So if the number of ones change, this means that there is some error, okay? So the number of ones is like 7, it changes to 8. Then خلاص, I put the 8 here as the number of ones. If the number of ones change, then the data has some error. Of course, this is very simplistic. The error checking is much more complicated than this. Okay? So this actually detects the error. So the error checking field will be able to detect that there is an error. Okay? Error checking can have some detection and correction. So because if I detect only, if the data link layer detects that there is an error, what does it do with the frame? It will drop it. It will drop it. Okay? And then, what will happen when I drop it? When somehow the source needs to know. And when it knows that there was some problem with the data, it will retransmit it. This is part of the protocol, whether the protocol provides reliable communication or unreliable communication. But as far as I'm concerned, there's no point of sending up anything in error. So when there is any error in the data, I will drop it. مش دعوه بقى ايه the protocol will tell me whether this needs to be retransmitted or provide unreliable communication, in which case we don't have to retransmit it, whatever. Okay? So that's one. Number two, which is more important, control access to the medium. Okay? So this is very important. Control the access to the medium, which means that we are talking about a shared medium. There is some level of sharing in the medium, okay? Similar to what we talked about when we talked about multiplexing and segmentation. So if the here we're talking about it from a very low level point of view. So we have some shared medium. The best way to visualize and understand this second functionality is again to assume that we are in a meeting, okay, and we need to arrange or organize how the speeches are going to go. Are we going to have some turns, or whoever has something to say will raise his hand, and someone has to decide whether I give you the floor or someone else? There are different ways of controlling the access to a shared floor or shared medium. Okay, we'll talk about the details of this in the next chapter, and we will talk about much more details in Network 2. But this is a core functionality of the detailing layer. Each of these functionalities is actually done by a sublayer. So then the data link control is actually the only layer that's subdivided into two layers. One is called logical link control, and the other one is called medium access control. Okay? So the logical link control sublayer is the layer that takes the packet from the upper layer and then it forms the frame. It forms the data structure of the frame. Okay? So it adds the header and the trailer, and then it fills the error checking field. Okay? And then it sends down to the MAC layer, and the MAC layer will be responsible for the addressing part, as we will talk about in a minute. So the question now is, why do we need to separate the data link layer? And in fact, it's the only layer that's subdivided into two sublayers. Why? Why do we need to subdivide this into two sublayers? Any guessing? Any guess? Based on your reading or your listening to the video?
To facilitate the access between the network access layer and physical layer.
It
depends on the network
medium. Physical medium. Yeah. So it turns out MAC layer, in order to organize the control to the medium, it's heavily dependent on the properties of the physical medium that we are using. Whether we're talking about a copper cable, wireless, fiber optics, and in fact, under each of these categories, there are multiple ways of how to organize the access to the medium. So this one is heavily medium dependent. But error checking is independent of the type of the medium to a great extent. So logical link control is medium independent, whereas MAC sublayer is medium dependent. So that's why they decided to separate. The other reason, so there are two reasons. The other reason is that based on the functionality of the LLC, they found that LLC can be performed purely in software, which is good, okay? But MAC layer, because it's heavily dependent on the physical medium, it has to deal with how the signals are transmitted over that physical medium, in which case MAC layer has to be implemented in hardware, okay? So these are the two reasons. LLC is software, MAC layer is hardware, LLC is medium independent, MAC layer is medium dependent. Wadih kada? Any question?
I don't understand what you mean by dependent.
Depends on the properties of the physical medium. Whether we are using copper, what type of copper, UTP, STP, whether we're using wireless. So the MAC layer, and that's why actually in the standard, we'll talk about the standard in a minute. when we talk about the standard, IEEE, for example, they developed the standards for access control layer. Okay, so there are some numbers for these standards, and they always talk about the standards grouping MAC layer with the physical layer, because they are done in hardware. Okay, but the LLC is separate. It's on its own in a separate standard. Why? Because they have to develop this standard once and for all, because it's medium independent. So they did one standard for logical link control, and this standard actually works for all types of media. What? Banana, MAC layer and physical layer, they are heavily dependent on the physical means. So they have to do one for Ethernet, one for Wi-Fi, one for Bluetooth, one for fiber optics, and so on. Okay, because MAC layer and physical layer are heavily medium dependent. Okay, and they are done in skinny in hardware.
So the frame is passed from the logical
in the source, yes. This is encapsulation, yes. On the destination, at the destination side, we do decapsulation. So we go MAC, LLC, and then network layer. We do decapsulation. Okay. So that's a brief introduction about the basic functionality of the data link layer and why we subdivided that into two sub layers for facilitating the medium dependency and so on. So the first activity we'll talk about today is regarding the generic format of the protocol data unit in the data link layer, which is what we call frame, the frame format. This generic format has been developed by as part of the reference model by ISO, okay? And as we said before, the reference model defines abstract or provides abstract definition, okay, of the protocol data unit in every layer. And then it leaves the details to the standard developers. It's not, as we said before, reference model does not map to a specific protocol suite. صح? So to us, with the language of the object-oriented course, يعني, this is abstract class. Okay? And then everyone inherits from that class to provide more details. Okay? So this is only the generic definition. When we go further, we will add more details. When we talk about Ethernet standards, we'll have to talk about much more details, why this field, what it does, and so on. So I'll give you 2 minutes to map the boxes in the proper location, and then try to question yourself, why do we need to have this field here? Okay? Why here? Why not in any other location? And we need to discuss that. So the basic protocol data unit includes what? Includes the header. And this is the packet or the data. And this is the trailer, right? Okay? Okay? So the header is divided into what? What is the first field?
Frame start.
And then?
Addressing.
And then? Type. And then control. And then the data. And then?
Error.
Detection. And then? Frame start. Okay. Okay, so let's criticize that. Let's question why do we need to put these fields in that sequence? Why frame start and frame stop? By the way, data link layer is the only layer that has frame start or frame stop that marks the beginning and the end. Why?
Because the
two
sub-layers
are like
this.
Why?
For the
sub-layers
to...
No.
Because
it's divided
into two sub-layers.
No, same answer. No.
Frame
start. No, the for error detection, this is the field response for error detection. Well, it turns out data link layer is the first layer that converts stream of bits with no structure, okay, into a predefined data structure. Okay? So if you have ones and zeros, I want to know where is the frame which I will take, and then I will convert it into an header, a header and a trailer and fields and stuff. Remember, this is a data structure. With the data structure course, you know that data has certain structure, which means has fields, has like some parameters and so on and so forth. Okay? The physical layer has no structure. It's just a stream of bits. In programming, this corresponds, if you have tried this before, some of you have tried this before, it needs some heavy programmer, يعني, to know this. In some cases, before you send any class content, you say serialize, class.serialize. You serialize all the content of a data structure into stream of bits, and then you send it over the line. Okay? So serialize removes any structure from the data and converts it into stream of bits. That's what the data link layer does in the encapsulation direction. For the decapsulation, I need something to tell me, okay, so when I go through the bits, I need something to tell me, oh, this is a beginning of a new frame. And then I will start to take that until this is the end of that frame. So I will take this, and then I'll start to process it. Because before this, stream of bits have no structure. Okay, so why don't we have this in any other layer? Because actually, once I get the data structure, I will deal with it as a data structure from now on. When I send to the network layer, I will send the data structure ready. I will send the buffer that contains the packet. And this buffer has beginning and end. And what actually happens is that data link layer will send the pointer of that buffer to the network layer. I feel pointer. It puts it on a buffer and then it sends the pointer to the network layer. That's it. So once I send the pointer, I know the beginning and I know the end. So I don't have to use again packet, stop, packet, start. I don't have to do that because it's a well-defined data structure from now on. But the data link layer is the first layer that has to deal with how from a serialized data, from a stream of bits, how to convert that to a well-defined data structure. Okay? All the other layers, they don't have this. They don't have to deal with this. Type address or addressing. Addressing, as we said, what type of address are we talking about here? We talked about two types of addresses, logical address and physical address, or we talked about three, actually, but which type of address is this? The logical or the physical? Is this the name of the person inside the house, or this indicates the location? No, this is the physical address. This is the name of the person inside the house. This is the MAC address or physical address. Okay? So why do we have the address at the beginning? That's tricky. The reason that we have the address at the beginning is that, especially here, remember, in the MAC layer, we're talking about hardware, صح? We need to be very fast. It turns out some network devices like switches, they don't need to actually read the data at all. They perform their functionality just by knowing the address. That's it. By knowing the physical address, they know how to send it over the LAN, over the local area network, without having to read the data. I don't have to read the data. I have the content, I just send it over the line, but I just need to read the address only. So that's why they put the address at the beginning so that they make it fast. I read it, perform the switching without having to read the data. Type, what is the type? Type identifies what or indicates what? No. This is protocol version. This is something else. Hmm. The protocol type. Protocol in which layer? In the upper layer, in the network layer. Okay, so why do I need to specify the protocol in the upper layer? Well, remember, again, starting from the data link layer, all the layers above are software. يعني ايه software. This so you have the data link layer here, and here is software, which means that the protocols run in what form in software? In a form of standalone processes. So this is process one, which represents IP protocol. This is process two, which represents IPX protocol. This is process three, which indicates, for example, ICMP protocol. Because in each layer, as we said before, we don't have one protocol only. We have many protocols, right? So when I have the frame here, I need to, as I said, I need to get the packet part and get the pointer and pass this pointer. Pass it to who? Who will tell me which way to send it? The type field. The type field will tell me whether to put it on the buffer for this process or this process or this process. Okay? So when I read the type field indicates, this is IP. Okay, so I will go and put it in the buffer where process one is running, and the IP will pick it up and then we'll start processing. Okay? So identifying the protocol in the upper layer, starting from the data link layer, is very, very important. And you will see it in all the upper layers. When we talk about all the standards in the upper layers, you will see that type field is there all the time. It's very, very important. Okay? Type. Control. The control field is responsible for facilitating the reliable communication. That's it. ISO stopped at this point. How reliable? We don't know. It depends on the standards. Okay? It's up to the standard developers to specify what level of reliability you want. Okay? Whether you want to provide flow control, you want to provide retransmission, timeouts, things like that. We'll discuss these things. But control field, as far as the generic frame format is concerned, this is for providing reliability. That's it. It's an abstract definition, and they left the details to the protocol developer. Then the data, and then the error detection. Error detection, we can have error detection and correction. As we said, error detection itself allows me to detect whether there is an error in the data. Okay? If there is an error in the data, then I'll drop it. Okay, by dropping this data, which means that I have to wait for this frame to be retransmitted again from the source in order to process it. Okay, and that might incur some delay, especially in some cases like some wireless. Wireless is slow, and so on. So sometimes retransmission takes some delay. In which case, they actually make the error checking more complicated. I don't only detect the error, I detect the location of that error. So I can detect where the error happened in the data, which means which bit is in error. If I detect which bit is in error, what do I do? What are the possible states for one bit? Two states, huh? If I know that this bit has an error, all I need to do is just to flip it. If it's one, I make it zero. If it's zero, I make it one. So I can perform some error detection and correction, which means if the data is in error, I will be able to correct it. But this requires these error checking fields will be much more complicated and in many cases much longer. We don't have to get to the details of this, but it's just enough for you to know that I can design this field to only detect the error and in some cases correct certain types of errors, okay? If the whole data is an error, I cannot correct it, of course.
But how does it know if there is an error or not?
As we said, a simple example, I will count the number of zeros. I will count the number of ones. Okay, so if the number of ones is changed, then I know that there was an error in the data. The more important question is, what are the sources of errors to the data? We talked about many things, right? Electromagnetic interference, radio frequency interference. We talked about lack of synchronization between the source and the destination, and the encoding scheme that we have does not have any self-synchronization. All of this might actually allow the or cause the receiver to misdetect one of these bits, which means decodes this bit in error. Okay? And in that case, there's no point to send it up, because if one bit is in error, there's no point to waste the time for all the upper layers. Okay? Right, in the data part, yes.
How does it know, if the data is correct or not?
What happens simply is that at the source, I will calculate something as a combination of this data, as I said, as a simple thing, the number of ones. The number of ones is 8. Okay, so I put here 8. Okay, so I send it over the LAN. Over the LAN, there was some error. So the number of ones, of course, some of the bits will change. Okay, so the number of ones will become 9 or will become 7. Okay, type. At the destination side, the destination will say, okay, let me read the data. Count the number of ones in the data. The number of ones is 9. Okay, what do I have in the error checking field? 8. Okay, so it does not match. واضح كده؟ So that's a very simple example. So this is the generic format of that frame. So this exercise, of course, is a piece of cake. So it's just matching the functionality of the field. Of course, we discussed that in details now, so you should be able to do it in a few seconds. So what contains the IP header, the transport layer header, and the transport layer PDU, and the data? It's that, right? So as we said, the frame itself has header, trailer, and the data. This data actually contains what? Contains the packet. So the packet contains the network header and all of this. So this is data. What identifies the layer 3 protocol used by the LLC type? What marks the end of the frame? This is frame stop. This is clear. Identifies source and destination. This is a addressing, and specify special flow control services. This is a control. This is part of that. What level of reliability you want to have? Flow control, error control, retransmission, all of this is part of the reliable type. This exercise tries to match the standard name with the organization that developed it. And of course, the very common question that I get always is that, do we have to memorize this? I get this question all the time. In a way, yes. It's bad news. Okay, so you need to at least identify, when you look at the name, you need to at least first identify whether this is like IEEE standard or ITU standard. Type Y, يعني ليه العذاب ده يعني. Well, we want to graduate graduates with some rich knowledge, so it doesn't actually make any sense that when you graduate and you work in telecom company, these are basics. But when it comes to the telecom companies, these are basics. So at least you need to be able to match. And I will make this very easy for you. I will give you some hints that will make this matching exercise very, very easy for you. Okay? And in fact, we'll talk about the details of some of these standards, and later on you will memorize it by heart. You don't actually have to spend time on memorizing them. But first, I'll give you a few. Type, any guess? Any guess? Huh? Which one? IEEE. Yeah, okay. So which ones here belong to IEEE?
802.15.
Bravo, Alec. Okay. So anything that starts with 802, it's halas. It's very straightforward. So this is IEEE. And this one is IEEE. So IEEE is responsible for standardizing network access protocols, okay, for different types of physical media. When it comes to network access protocols, we said this is the protocol that includes what? So in the layers, we have MAC, and we have PHY, and we have LLC. So this is one standard. So for example, 802.11 is the standard for MAC and PHY for wireless, Wi-Fi. And here we have Wi-Fi, we have G, we have B, we have different variations of this. Okay, depending on frequency ranges and so on and so forth. Yeah, before we get to that, 802.4 talks about, again, a specific type of medium, which is talking ring, and we'll talk about this. And again, this is one of the standards that's obsolete and nobody uses them. And again, we'll talk about why. Ethernet is 802.3. Okay, so 802.3 is the standard for Ethernet, which talks about copper cable. It's not wireless, but copper cable. And it includes the standards for how the MAC and PHY are specified, the detailed specification for MAC and PHY, not the LLC. 802.2 is the standard for LLC. It's a separate standard for LLC. Why? Because if you notice, 802.2, it's done once and for all. Because it's a medium, it's software, صح, and it's medium A. Independent. So for all the other standards, 802.3, 802.4, 802.11, 802. Whatever, the LLC always has a 802.2. So it's one standard. And MAC and PHY can be 802.3, 802.4, 802.11, whatever. It can change depending on the medium. Okay? But LLC is only done once and for all. Type. This is IEEE is responsible for standardizing the network access protocols. Anything that starts with G or Q is simply ITU. Okay, so this is ITU. And again, ITU is responsible for standardizing network access control and particularly physical layer when it comes to standards like ADSL. We know ADSL is for accessing the internet, or multimedia standards like ISDN. So anything that starts with G or Q is ITU. Okay? The X standards are not protocols. These are standards for the connectors of the physical medium. Like BNC, like X actually is the connector for fiber optics. RJ45 is the connector for the UTP and STP, the plastic termination of any Ethernet cable. Okay, and you'll be able to do this configuration in the lab. So this is done by ANSI. Okay, and the rest, of course, all this. The letter abbreviations like this is done by Isaac. Okay? So I hope this hint is useful to at least match and identify which organization worked on developing which of these standards. Any questions?